This is another episode of The Transition Expert, and I'd like to welcome our newest guest, Jessica. Hi, Jessica. How are you today?
I'm doing well. Thank you.
So, Jessica, tell us what happened that made you, or encouraged you, rather, to contact Lifecycle to assist you.
So my mother has lived in this big, beautiful house. I think she bought it in 79, 80, maybe. Mm-hmm. The past, I want to say maybe 10 years or so, she's always had kind of a tendency to shop a lot and acquire a lot of things. The house slowly but surely started to get full. My stepfather died in 2019, and his death was extremely hard on her. And since then, her tendencies have gotten greater. It was a decline for her mental health, and obviously the condition of the home, because of depression and anxiety. She passed away last July, 2021. Very unexpectedly. It was a heart attack, and we know it was a broken heart. Her heart was broken. She was struggling and passed away. So I am, for the last 13 months, I've been keeping her house up, paying, what was the mortgage, and trying to clean it out to sell. And I've had help from family and friends, and it's just become such an overwhelming job. And mentally and emotionally for me, it's very hard to be in this house. I'm the one who discovered my mother after she passed, and she was in this house. So there's kind of an energy here that it's difficult for me to be here. And the just amount of stuff is very overwhelming. So I actually called you while my mother was still here. I want to say maybe 2020. I talked to you, and then I talked to my mother, and I said, this could really help us. This could really get you to a good place, and maybe in a smaller place that's more manageable for you. And she wasn't at the place where she could do that. And despite all my encouragement, she just wasn't at the place where she was ready to get help. And I think a big part of that was in her family. Her side of the family is very, present as if everything is okay. Don't let anybody know if you're struggling, and certainly don't get professional help. And it was kind of that fear of being judged, and what are people gonna think? And I don't need this. I'm okay. And it was just, that's how it was just ingrained in her from a very, wow, very young age. And one of the reasons I wanted to do, when you said the podcast, I got excited because I'm one of those people that I think we need to talk about mental health more. Absolutely. We need to strip away all that fear and that shame. It's not shameful. We all struggle. We all have our demons, and it's okay to ask for help. And, right, there are people who will help and are not judgmental and are compassionate. And I know that my mother, there was potential for her to have a longer time with us and it to be a happier time with us if she was willing to get the help that she needed. So kind of, for this, for me, it's kind of, myself, it's healing too, because the past year, I've been very kind of protective, and I understood she was embarrassed. So I kind of wanted to keep all what she was going through kind of close, but I don't think that's helpful to me. And I don't think, that's helpful to society either. We need to talk about it. We need to say it's okay, and we can support each other and help each other.
I agree. I think you're absolutely right. And you're one of the one of my few guests that has expressed herself so openly about a very important issue or topic, rather, is mental health. The older generation were more prone to pulling yourself up by your bootstraps, you know, never letting the outside world in. You're going to be judged. You should be ashamed. There was a lot more onus on protecting one's image and exhibiting a sense of strength, you know, which served you well in different times in a different era. But now the way things have changed and the way that the systems have evolved, people are under a lot more stress now than ever before. You know, the world isn't as simple anymore, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I read a quote the other day that kind of, and I'm, you know, paraphrasing here, people don't connect to perfection. You don't connect with people through that. You connect with people through experience and struggles. Absolutely. and that's how you make those connections that can be meaningful to your life. Presenting this as my life is wonderful, I'm happy, I don't have struggles, I've got everything under control. All right. That's not real. That's not real. It's life. Not. And that's not how you connect with people.
100%.
I think a lot of people are searching for what's real and what's raw, and sometimes it's ugly and uncomfortable, but it's okay. That's life. That's us being human. And I think we need more of that. And then we need people to not be afraid to be like, I need help. I'm struggling. This is hard for me.
Yes. So. I mean, that was what the whole show platform was created on, is the openness on mental health. I mean, when we first started this journey, life cycle, we just thought we were going into homes and we're just going to help people, you know, transition physically their belongings. And what we realized is that people were a lot more attached to those belongings. Those belongings had a story, and a lot of those stories resonated or manifested itself in a form of trauma. You know, could you share with me what your mom's life, childhood life, and did she experience her own personal traumas?
I mean, she got dealt a tough hand at life. When she was 12, she was one of five kids. She was the baby. When she was 12, her father passed away. And she had struggled with that, because her father was sick. And her mother, my grandmother, was a nurse, a registered nurse, which was very unheard of in that day. But she was taking care of him in the home. And I guess all of her older siblings were kind of allowed to go in the room and help and things like that. And my grandmother felt my mother was too young for that, to see her father that way, and tried to protect her by not allowing her into the room. And she carried that, you know, you know, my grandmother, it came from a good place. My grandmother was trying to protect her, thought she was doing the right thing. And maybe it was, maybe it would have been too much for my mother to see her father in that condition, but that was something she held. And then, you know, her role in the family changed because her mother was working. Her older siblings also got a job to help out, and she was at home. So she took care of cooking and cleaning and providing meals to the family. And then, you know, she got older, she got her degree, she was a teacher, met my biological father at Cumberland High School, and they fell in love, got married, tried to have a baby. She had a son, Joshua, who lived for 5 hours and passed away. And that was another thing that she held onto and never fully processed that loss. Also had a miscarriage too. And then when she got pregnant with me, she even told my dad, this is it. And then I was born. And 11 weeks later, my father died of a heart attack while jogging at 35.
Wow.
So she's alone with a newborn after maternity leave. And you know, she dealt with that. And
did she get help? I mean, do you know if she got help at that age, at that stage?
She went to one group therapy session. and never went back. And that was it. And
what was the support group in the immediate family? I mean, how did your family come together in that situation for her?
My aunt, her sister, was at our house almost every weekend. And she lived up in Acton, Massachusetts, where I'm Pawtucket, Rhode Island. So it was, you know, a drive. And my grandmother moved in with us and lived with us till I was about like 3 or 4. She had support from her family. And, you know, my biological father's family was also very supportive. She found it hard to be around them, though.
Why?
It was kind of that reminder of him, and it was a painful thing for her. Not that she didn't love them.
Just triggers.
It was triggers. But she did have support. But unfortunately, it wasn't professional. You know, there's only so much support that your family can give you. And you know, a mental health professional could really dive deep and work through that trauma and work through that loss with you. And she never got that. So it manifested in different coping strategies that were not very healthy.
Talk to me about those coping tactics that she embraced.
So at first it was, you know, her focus was me. I mean, like everything came down to me. And my aunt, on my biological father's side had recently told me, you know, she would come and be like, oh, I want to take Jess to go to the beach for the day or take her to do this for a couple hours. And my mother would be so full of anxiety of me being away from her.
Wow.
And it was difficult for her to let anybody, even family members who she trusted, take me and us be separated. There was separation anxiety there. So that kind of happened. And she was a shopper. I mean, she had always been a shopper, you know. So she shopped and bought things and made sure she bought things for people. She was very generous, you know. She would buy things and give them to people and everything. And I didn't want for anything as a child.
I want to go into how she coped with the actual material things, the purchasing, the buying, the collecting, accumulating. But tell me how you and your mom's relationship, did you feel at times when you were growing up misunderstood? And did you feel that your mom was a little bit overbearing and maybe a little bit suffocating in a sense?
I did at times. And that was more when I was older. When I was younger, I was very much attached. I mean, obviously you're attached to your mother, but it was a very intense attachment. And she kind of cultivated that. And then she started dating my stepfather, who I call dad. So if I say dad, that's who I mean, my stepfather, because he was my father figure. He helped raise me. And her focus shifted from me to him and his 4 adult children. And I was 9 or 10 years old at the time.
Oh, so it was you and mom, and now this other person's coming in.
Yeah.
Was he a disciplinarian, like?
No, he was amazing. He was calm, he was gentle, he was patient. And I gave him a run for his money when he first came. Oh yeah. I was not nice to him, and he loved me anyway. And we ended up having a wonderful relationship when I kind of like, you know, snapped out of it and realized, you know,
you got a good thing here.
Yeah. And, so we had a really wonderful relationship, and he was a very calming presence to my mother. He grounded her.
I was going to ask you, how old were you when your biological dad passed away?
11 weeks old.
Oh, so you really didn't.
Yeah, I don't have any real memories of him. I have a lot of stories because he was talked about a lot growing up through my mother, through family. And my stepfather actually also worked at Cumberland High School with him, too. He and my stepfather and my mother had been friends for almost their entire adult lives. before.
So you actually knew your dad.
Yeah, yeah. So he told me stories about my dad too. They actually had like a free period together where they would sit and joke and laugh. And so I had all those things. So, you know, and my mom and my stepdad were very much in love, and it's they kind of felt like they were destined for each other. He had lost his wife as well. And they always kind of said, like, they thought, you know, his wife and my biological father kind of put them on this path to find each other, to have that, you know, love again. And then he passed away in 2019. And it was the timing of it was very interesting, because my biological dad passed away on April 6th and my stepfather passed away on April 8th. And my mom was very big in dates. Like, she would very hold on to anniversaries of deaths and significant dates. She was very, you know, so that also. And I mean, in between all that, she had lost a brother to cancer. He was only 52. Mm-hmm. Her brother passed away. Her other brother passed away in 2018. And her mother passed away. That was in 2012. Her mother-in-law passed, you know, she had a lot of loss.
So just constant loss.
Constant loss, you know. And then the last 2 years, she just was so sad. So sad. And then COVID hit. And she was stressed, as many teachers were, trying to figure out how to teach remotely. So she and I kind of vented to each other about that a lot, because we were both teachers. And she was very isolated too during that time, and with all the memories and the triggers. And
so let me ask you a question too, because mm-hmm. now that we're on that subject, I want to ask you about your mom in two ways. What was your mom like with all the trauma and loss that she had with collecting things? Did she exhibit any attachment to things? Was she a big shopper prior to your stepdad passing away?
She was. When her and my biological father got married, he would say to his sister, you know, she goes to the grocery store and she buys so much food for just the two of us. And then she goes back the next week and buys it again. And so it seemed that that was a coping mechanism from very early on, and it just gradually got more and more out of control.
Let me interject a little bit there. So for the viewers that are watching in, when people think that people are buying things, they often think that, you know, okay, this is a person who is going through a rough breakup, so they need to go get ice cream because it's soothing. Mm-hmm. But that's not always the case when it comes to situations like buying things in abundancy. For example, if you grew up in a post-depression or you grew up in an environment where you didn't have food, your love language is to go buy things in abundance to make sure that you don't go without, to make sure that you have these things. And you mentioned something about your mom earlier on about how when your stepdad passed away, she was all about you. Everything was about you. And she wanted to make sure you were okay. And she had separation anxiety. Well, when it comes to some elements, not all, but in some elements of the buying and the purchasing, it's a reassurance of making sure that the family dynamic is intact and no one's going without. And it sounds simple to most of us. We're never going to go without raviolis. We're never going to starve because we don't have enough bread. But in your mom's case, you know, that could have been her way of dealing with the traumas. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. It definitely was. I got to make sure not only I have enough, but the people I love have enough too. And there's actually, after my stepfather died that summer, my mom and dad would always go up to the Cape to see one of my nieces dance. She was, you know, a competitive dancer. So my mom made the trip on her own after my dad passed and said, oh, I'm going to stop at the store. I'm going to get a few snacks for Emma and her friends. She pulls up to the hotel. Her entire back seat of her car is filled to the top with, you know, those huge boxes of snacks from like BJ's, right? Like like, not just like, okay, a couple bags of chips. Like, she did everything was in abundance because she, you know, she had 14 grandkids. So she spoiled them. And it's interesting that you said that was her love language, because I never thought of it that way, but it was. It was that I need, you know, I'm going to have you, you're going to have what you need and what you want, because I want to make sure you are taken care of. And that was her.
That's why she did what she did to you, not to interject, but when you mentioned that you never went without, right? And then you also made a point that you said your mom bought a lot of things, but she gave away a lot of things.
Yeah.
That was her love language. And if you had to summarize who your mom was, that was who she was, a giver.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so I mean, it was just, and the house, it was gradually, it was always, it's always a gradual thing of accumulating. And, you know, after my dad died, it was just kind of like, okay. She and I did make some progress the summer before she died. She was at the point where she's like, I know I need to get this house cleaned out. We had gotten to the point where she understood she had to sell the house and move, you know, downsize. And we did make progress, and I was proud of her. And I told her, I said, I'm so proud of you. You're making decisions and you're letting go of things. And that's so good. Unfortunately, you know, we got the downstairs kind of like cleaned out and livable. And then, you know, within a month or two, it was filled up again because she was shopping. That, you know, the underlying part of it wasn't addressed. Human behavior is always based on something, you know, it's always based on an underlying issue. There's a reason we do some of the things that we do. We don't just do them. So she was so overwhelmed, and she just couldn't get out of it. And, you know, and I think it was that fear of what are people going to think? And this was a side of herself that she hid from a lot of people, you know, where she would go places. She was always very put together and looked great and everything. And she, you know, had, you know, she had great taste and everything. And she hid this part of herself. Some of her closest
friends
didn't know. And these are people that, you know, I'm still obviously in touch with, and I've shared it with them. And I said, look, she was suffering. She was suffering, and they had no idea. And they're compassionate, though. These people love you. You know, they love her. They're not going to judge. If I showed them the house, they didn't react like, oh, she was lazy, she was slut. No, none of that is true. She was suffering. And, you know, that's, I think, what some people automatically assume when they see a hoarding situation or, you know, anything like that, like, oh, this person is just, but that's not the case. And I think if we talk about it and we are like, no, this is what it actually is. I think hopefully more people can be okay with like, okay, it's okay for me to ask for help, because I feel like my mom's story is like a cautionary tale.
Absolutely.
Because like I said, I think her outcome could have been so different if she got the help she needed and the support, professional support that she needed, because she didn't have a lack of support from family and friends, but sometimes that's not enough. It's okay that's not enough.
No, I mean, I agree. I think you hit it right on the nail. I think your mom was at a point at different points in her life where she was right there at the door. And I think it happened at some point before your stepfather passed on, that maybe she had an opportunity. And then after he passed away in 2020, when you initially reached out, I think that was around the time that I think she was making some headway. And maybe even before her death, I think she was probably looking at making some moves. I look at homes in differently than anyone else. As a transition expert, I go into situations for a lot of reasons. And it's never just because someone's lazy or because they just don't want to do anything. Your home tells you so much more about you than any other facet. We all, ironically, due to the pandemic, wore masks. But what we had to learn is when we take off those masks, you know, we don't longer have to put that facade in and have to be that person. Your mom was a remarkable woman from hearing what you're telling me. And she was a very talented, very compassionate, very, very professional woman in her professional life in terms of how she taught her students, and she gave everything. But I feel that, you know, this is a cautionary tale of how important self-care is. And in this case, you know, tell me a little bit about how you have changed the narrative with taking care of yourself. What are you doing these days now?
So I want to say almost 4 years of my life have been, and I just said this to my best friend, they've been hell for me, for different reasons. I had some personal things, and then my father died, and then, you know, everything else happened. And I was very much kind of in the place that my mother was, where I was kind of just surviving, kind of, you know, felt like couldn't catch a break, all this thing. And I started to kind of prioritize myself. I want to say 2020 was when I started doing that. If anything, from teaching in a pandemic, it helped me find a work-home-life balance, which I know a lot of teachers struggle with. And I, like that year that I, in 2020, I went back in the classroom, and it was all kind of, you know, distancing and all that. And I really learned, like, I can't work 24/7. I need to take care of myself, and I need to be, you know, so I can give 100% to my students and give 100% to my family. So I started that, and that worked well for me. And then, you know, slowly I kind of started making some changes in my life. I was in a very toxic work environment up until March of this year, where it was, you know, very difficult for me to be there. And I made the leap. I made a big change, and I, you know, went to a different school, and it was the best move I made.
Wonderful.
And it was scary. It was scary. But did it scared, because I was like, something has to change, and I can sit here and I can complain about it, or I can take this leap and see where I land. And that's what I did. And I'm at the point now with this house. This house is very, there's a lot to this house for me. There's a lot of mixed emotions. There's a lot of energy. And it took me 13 months to get to this place with this house that I'm like, it is time for me to let go. It is time for me to face the reality of what this house is now, that it's no longer the house it was. And to move on with my life. There's a lot of things that I myself cannot work through. While unfortunately, this house has become a burden. It has become a weight, and I cannot deal with, you know, I mean, the trauma of finding my mother in this house, right? You know, and I cannot deal with any of that until this chapter is closed. So it feels to me I've kind of been in this limbo for 13 months. And when you and I met and we talked about the plan, I think we were standing in the backyard and you told me, this is what I can do for you. And I literally felt like I could breathe for the first time in 4 years.
Thank you. That means a lot.
So
yeah.
I'm just so grateful. I'm grateful for you and your team. So thank you.
Thank you. I mean, and I'm just going to summarize what we came up with. Initially, you know, as a transition company, we work with clients that are in transition, and we explore an anomaly of options. You know, option A, B, and C. You know, do you want to live here, Mrs. Smith? If you do want to live here, what does living here look like for you? You know, your bathroom's on the first floor, on the second floor, but you spend most of your time on the first floor. We can build a bathroom, or we can think of an alternate plan, which may not require you living in this home. But if you want to live here, we're going to deal with the adaptive accessibility components if there is a need for it. We're going to deal with the cleaning, the clutter, decluttering, renovations, repairs, and all the things so that you can stay where you are and live peacefully in your home. And option B is a fair market comparable analysis. Let's blow this thing through the rafters. Let's get this place to tip top shape. Let's look at what the house across the street has, yours doesn't, and let's go all in. And then we have what we refer to as a home rescue program, which is designed specifically for people who don't have the time, money, energy, resources, or emotional bandwidth to withstand a lot of the rigor of what goes into investing time, energy, and resources into a development project like a home. You know, there's that old crap moment, you know, when you open up a wall and you recognize that, you know, there's something there. When we presented all these options to you and we wanted you to make the decision that was the best one for you, talk to me a little bit about why, what decision made the most sense for you?
For me, it was the home rescue. You're not just kind of rescuing the home, you're kind of rescuing me from this seemingly impossible situation. And that just seemed, like I said, when I heard it, it was just like, oh, okay, yeah, that's what I need to do. And there was very little hesitation on my part, where I can't say that that would have been the case even a month ago. Right. I think it's all kind of an internal process of you know, going through things and really dealing with what has happened and what is going to happen. But to me, this home rescue is my light at the end of the tunnel. And it is, I feel like it's going to be a big turning point in my life up to this point, that I can close this chapter. I can get the help I need, because yes, I am getting the professional help. I am in therapy. I am taking medication. I am doing that work on myself to deal with what I need to deal with, so I can be the best mother, wife, teacher, friend, sister, everything. And the best for myself too. And I recognize that what I'm dealing with here is holding me back from all of that. So it's the first step in kind of reclaiming my life and starting to live and not just survive.
That means a lot, and that says a lot. And I think, if nothing more, this conversation, this show, this meet and greet that we connected by you coming on the show and you coming to us and looking for advice and direction and assistance, is going to change the lives of millions of people that are going to watch this show. I've been doing this for 13 years, and unbeknownst to myself, you know, I didn't think that I needed a help. And let me tell you what therapy is. You know, therapy is the ability to have a sense of introspective in what you're and how what you're doing, how you're doing, and how you're doing, and checking in with yourself and being able to say, you know, how are you feeling? Like, I thought that I was an Iron Man. I can go out and help people going through all these sorts of issues, and I didn't need anyone to help me until 4 years ago. I went and started getting help to speak about my own problems, my own childhood, my own traumas, and all the things that I did, that when I did that, I became so much better at what I was doing, because it allowed me to see myself in a different light. And I think that's what getting help is all about, especially from professionals, people like that are teachers, that are doctors, that are nurses, people like your mom, who think that their job on this planet and their love language, rather, is just to purely help other people. They need to take another look at themselves and be able to say, how am I helping myself? Self-care is about taking the time to check in with yourself and to be able to say, how are you doing? You know, and being honest with yourself and having that open exchange with another person as a soundboard allows for a much healthier version of yourself.
Yeah, and I think that term self-care has been thrown around a lot in the past couple of years, and it's much more than, you know,
getting your nails done.
Getting your nails done, or like putting a face mask on it. That's not. It's deeper than that. It's deeper than that. And you know, tomorrow to be a better version of ourselves than we were today, and that takes work.
Absolutely.
right? That takes work, and it doesn't just happen. You have to put in the work, and you need help to do that. Most of the time, you need help to do that.
You absolutely do. I mean, Jessica, you've been an excellent guest. I really appreciate, you coming on the show. I'm just enamored with everything that you've shared with us today. I'm excited to take you on as another life cycle transition client. The team is, working their way into your doors as we speak.
Yeah.
So before I let you go, I want you to share with the guests, just basically tell them if they're going through something similar to what you've gone through with your mom, with yourself, with everything that you've experienced up until this point in your life, what advice would you give them to encourage them to be their best version of themselves, to do well and be well?
I think it starts with being honest with yourself. Be honest with yourself about what's going on and what you need, and be open to, kind of unapologetically, and realize that you're not the only one going through things and struggling, and nobody expects anybody to be perfect, and reach out, get the help you need, because when you're in it, sometimes you can't see that life could be so different for you, and life can be better than what you imagine, because sometimes we're so closed off and in it that it seems hopeless, but it's not. And it's hard. It's not easy. It takes work. It takes persistence, and you're going to break down, and you're going to have backslides and everything, but you just have to realize that there's a life that you deserve, and don't hold yourself back from it, because a lot of times we hold ourselves back from the life we deserve. So I guess just be open and honest to that and ask for the help. It's not shameful. It's not, you're not any less of a person by asking for help.
Great, great answer and great insight. It's coming from a really genuine place, a place of experience, a place of growth. I commend you for your journey, everything that you've gone through. I'm sure the millions of people who are going to be watching this episode are going to learn from. If you're tuning in to this show is all about just that. I mean, if you're a loved one or someone you know that are going through something and haven't quite gotten the right resources to deal with those things, if they're ashamed, if they're embarrassed, if they were brought up in a similar situation as Jessica's mom, where they were taught to not let the outside world in, don't. Please get help. Contact your primary care and let your insurance company know. Reach out to your loved ones. Go to your church. Go to your spiritual guru. Whoever you confide in, talk to someone. Don't lock the door, don't close the door, don't shut the world out. Open yourself to being a better version of yourself, to get help and to heal. This is all about that emotional journey, that spiritual journey, and the physical journey of taking you from one state, one place, to a better place in a healthier world. This is another episode of The Transition Expert. I'd like to thank Jessica yet again for being such a wonderful guest on the show.
Thank you so much for having me, and thank you for what you're doing for me. I appreciate it.
You're very welcome. You're very welcome. And, tune in to the next episode. And Jessica, I'll be seeing you shortly because I'll be coming by to visit. All right.
Okay. Sounds good.
You're welcome. Bye now.